And welcome to all of you as we gather here on this Good Friday, and a God who meets us in this time as we gather at the foot of the cross in the days, in these important days of Holy Week, but also in these hours this afternoon to behold his suffering. They say that some of the most profound words are often spoken by one who knows they are close to death. And today, as we spend time in the presence of a Savior, he does just that. He speaks words to us. And as we meditate on these words, we pray that God meets us where we are with that incredible gift of why he has come and what he has done for us as a Savior who loves us, even to the point of death. We're glad you're here today as we gather in his presence today. And Almighty God, we ask you graciously to behold this your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hand of wicked people, and to suffer death upon the cross. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you in the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. A reading from the Passion of our Savior. When he had finished praying, Jesus left with his disciples and crossed the Kidron Valley. And on the other side there was a garden, and he and his disciples went into it. Now Judas, who betrayed him, knew the place because Jesus had often met there with his disciples. So Judas came to the garden, guiding a detachment of soldiers and some officials from the chief priests and the Pharisees. They were carrying torches, lanterns, and weapons. And Jesus, knowing all that was going to happen to him, went out and asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they replied. "I am he," Jesus said. And Judas the traitor was standing there with them. And when Jesus said, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. And again he asked them, "Who is it you want?" "Jesus of Nazareth," they said. "I told you that I am he. If you are looking for me, then let these men go." And this happened so that the words he had spoken would be fulfilled. "I have not lost one of those you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's servant, cutting off his right ear. The servant's name was Malchus. And Jesus commanded Peter, "Put your sword away. Shall I not drink the cup the Father has given me?" This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise
Two other men, both criminals, were also led out with him to be executed. And when they came to the place called the Skull, there they crucified him, along with the criminals, one on his left, the other on his right. Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing." These are not just words spoken in a moment of agony. They're words that reflect the most profound demonstration of mercy and love that the world has ever known. Unparalleled grace amidst unimaginable suffering. Here we witness the epitome of Jesus' divine nature. For his human nature was in medical shock, he's on a downward pathway to physical death. No mere human being could have said these words. Only the God-man person of Jesus could show boundless mercy and forgiveness in a moment like this. Imagine the scene for a moment. Jesus, innocent, blameless, crucified along with two criminals. He is mocked. He is scorned. He is ridiculed by those who pass by. Yet in his agony, he utters words, eternal words. "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." Golgotha, the place of the skull. It was called that because it had once been a place for beheading criminals. But the Romans had amped up their capital punishment. For Golgotha was now the place of crucifixion, punishment that was meant to inflict pain and agony and torture and revenge. The Romans worshipped revenge as one of their gods, waging war on countries that had done them wrong. Revenge to them was an art of warfare, and the sweetest was when they would conquer people and enslave them. This is our backdrop to words of mercy. An earthly ruling revenge-seeking empire against Jesus offering forgiveness. And more than offering forgiveness, he offers absolution for the words and the wrongs done to him. Did he speak these words when the spikes were driven in? Was it a silent prayer throughout the previous night, during the trials, during the scourgings? Was it as the cross was lifted up, for Jesus said, "Just as Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, so the Son of Man must be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him may have eternal life." Whichever it was, it was spoken as a prayer for all involved that day and for all humankind forever. Evangelist Charles Spurgeon said of Jesus' words, "Jesus prays for us when we do not." Those involved that day weren't seeking forgiveness. So often in the midst of our own sin, neither do we. Notice the depth of Jesus' forgiveness. He doesn't wait for an apology or for a sign of remorse by those around. He doesn't withhold his forgiveness until wrong is acknowledged. His forgiveness is unconditional and immediate, freely to all, regardless of past actions or attitudes. Yet greater than just words being spoken, in Jesus speaking, he accomplishes what he offers. The book of Hebrews says, "Where there is forgiveness, there is no longer any offering for sin." Jesus' own sacrifice of himself on his cross, the very Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world, covered forever all sin through his own blood that he shed. He negated forever our bringing anything of our own, lest we try and make our own pathway to forgiveness apart from him. Jesus' ultimate power on earth was not in his healings or his feedings or his miracles. It was that he remained on the cross to offer his forgiveness. This truly is the church's identity and worth in our world. It is not in numbers or finances or programs, but it is in the fact that we offer and receive the forgiveness of Jesus. May we hear those words said over us again and again, for they were spoken this day for us. Amen.
And we pray. Lord Jesus, forgive us when we don't know what we do. And forgive us for all the times we do know what we do. Our need for you as a Savior who would go this way of death on our behalf is so great. And the fact that you do not push us aside or pull apart our relationship with you is a miracle. And today we come into your presence to behold this gift. And we pray that as we take in your word and your promises and your fulfillment of them, that Lord, you'd meet us in this time with your grace and your mercy and yes, your forgiveness. We give you thanks today as you live, Lord Jesus, as our Savior. And as a God who dies in our place, we thank you. Let us bless the Lord. we pray. Almighty God, we ask you graciously to behold this your family for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hand of wicked people and to suffer death upon the cross. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you in the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. In a reading from the Passion of our Savior. Then the detachment of soldiers with its commander and the Jewish officials arrested Jesus. They bound him and brought him first to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Now Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jewish leaders that it would be good if one man die for the people. And Simon Peter and another disciple were following Jesus. Because this disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the high priest's courtyard, but Peter had to wait outside at the door. The other disciple, who was known to the high priest, came back, spoke to the servant girl on duty there, and brought Peter in. "You aren't one of this man's disciples too, are you?" she asked Peter. And he replied, "I am not." It was cold, and the servants and officials stood around a fire they had made to keep warm. Peter also was standing with them, warming himself. And meanwhile, the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and his teaching. "I've spoken openly to the world," Jesus replied. "I always taught in synagogues or at the temple where all the Jews come together. I said nothing in secret. Why question me? Ask those who heard me. Surely they know what I said." And when Jesus said this, one of the officials nearby slapped him in the face. "Is this the way you answer the high priest?" he demanded. "If I said something wrong," Jesus replied, "testify as to what is wrong. But if I spoke the truth, why do you strike me?" Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Meanwhile, Simon Peter was still standing there, warming himself. So they asked him, "Are you one of his disciples too, are you?" He denied it, saying, "I am not." And one of the high priest's servants, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, challenged him, "Didn't I see you with him in the garden?" And again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, a rooster began to crow. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Comes from Luke chapter 23, verses 39 through 43. And one of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. "Aren't you the Christ? Save yourself and us." But the other criminal rebuked him. "Don't you fear God?" he said, "since you are under the same sentence. We are punished justly, for we're getting what our deeds deserve, but this man has done nothing wrong." And then he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus answered him, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise." This is the word of the Lord. The day ahead only held death in the minds of the two criminals. You see, they were getting what they deserved. We don't know exactly the full charges against them. One of them even admitted, "We're being punished justly." They could see no hope. They seemed resolved to no last-minute reprieves. No one to save them, no words of salvation. And then the two were joined by another on a cross. And they had obviously heard of this one. You see, that first criminal said to that man insultingly, "Aren't you the Christ?" And we have the first mention of salvation. "Aren't you the Christ? The anointed one, the chosen one, who is to come into the world and save it. Save yourself and save me." And that criminal really didn't believe that Jesus was going to save him. He was hoping for it, but he knew his plight. The second criminal, he knew something about Jesus also. "This man hasn't done anything wrong." The minds of the criminals were on judgment, their own. And it could be that the farthest thing from their minds at that moment on that day was salvation. It could be for each one of us that that might be the furthest thing from our minds also. You see, Good Friday, it's a day that the Christian church has historically dedicated to death. A somber mood, darkened lights. The color of the day is black. The music, it's not joyful. It's not usually sing-songy in any type of way. In reality, the mood of the day is a funeral. And for Peter, James, and John, and the other disciples, just like them, we have lost our friend to death. And it could be that the furthest thing from our minds is this idea of salvation. And yet I should be, we should be thinking about salvation on this Good Friday. For that's why Jesus was put there on the cross. That's why Jesus hung there on the cross. That's why Jesus died there on the cross, for salvation. Keeping the law that we could not keep. Taking the weight of sin upon himself that we could not hold up. Now, one of those criminals did express his desire to be saved, but he didn't realize that it came at a cost. He desired to be saved, but not to be repentant, not to be cleansed, not to be forgiven, not to be absolved, not to humble himself, not to be changed. He said to Jesus, "Just make me saved." And yet his sin and his self were in the way. And he needed that removed in order that he might be saved. And Jesus was right there for him, suffering and dying for him and his sins. And it was almost as the criminal was saying, "That's the furthest thing from my mind. I don't need your death. I just need to be saved." And the other criminal, he admitted it. He was not worthy. His sins of the past were standing in the way in his mind that no one could possibly save him. Salvation, a distant thought for him. And so all he could do was ask Jesus to remember him. This broken, sinful man, "Jesus, remember me." And I also almost wonder, was that criminal reminded of the words of David that we have recorded for us in Psalm 51. Hoping that those words would be true for him, where David writes, "Cast me not away from thy presence, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and uphold me with thy Spirit." And Jesus' mercy abounded to that criminal. And he said to them, "I tell you the truth, today you will be with me in paradise." And probably the furthest thing from this man's mind at that time. Who, me? Paradise? Today? Salvation? This man was about to physically die, but Jesus was telling him also that he was going to live, saved from this world of sin and alive to new salvation through Christ Jesus alone. Easter came early. Salvation was here. This same Jesus remembers you and me this day, and all of our sins, and all of our faults, and all of our failures. But in his death, he comes to us with a word of salvation. "I love you, my child, and I forgive you. Put your trust and faith in me." On this day of death, may we hear that word of salvation that comes from Jesus. You pray with me? Gracious Lord God, we pray you to lead us this day, that our minds would not be focused on death alone on this Good Friday, but that your Spirit would lead us in the understanding that all this took place for our salvation, a salvation that comes through Jesus Christ alone. Embrace us with your promises eternal as we put our full lives in eternity in his faithfulness. And it's in Jesus we ask it. Amen.
We pray. Lord God, if we are honest, we are all guilty as charged. We are as criminals on death row. And if we got what we deserved, Lord, death would be our story. It would be our future. It would be our eternity. And yet today, you've stepped into the mix to do something about it. Lord, we thank you that you do remember us in your kingdom and that you do call on us in faith. And you do bestow on us a gift of salvation made possible by who you are and all that you have done. So as we gather here in your presence today, Lord Jesus, so renew that reality in each of us, our minds, our hearts, our very souls, as a God who sets us free by who you've done and what you've done for us as our Savior. In Jesus' name, let us bless the Lord.
Oh,
Almighty God, we ask you graciously to behold this, your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hand of wicked people and to suffer death upon the cross. To the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you in the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. Continuation of the Passion of our Savior. Then the Jewish leaders took Jesus from Caiaphas to the palace of the Roman governor. By now it was early morning, and to avoid ceremonial uncleanness, they did not enter the palace because they wanted to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate came out to them and asked, "What charges are you bringing against this man?" "If he were not a criminal," they replied, "we would not have handed him over to you." And Pilate said, "Take him yourselves and judge him by your own law." "But we have no right to execute anyone," they objected. And this took place to fulfill what Jesus had said about the kind of death he was going to die. Pilate then went back inside the palace, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" "Is that your own idea?" Jesus asked. "Or did others talk to you about me?" "Am I a Jew?" Pilate replied. "Your own people and chief priests handed you over to me. What is it you have done?" And Jesus said, "My kingdom is not of this world. If it were, my servants would fight to prevent my arrest by the Jewish leaders. But now my kingdom is from another place." "Ah, you are a king then," said Pilate. But Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. In fact, the reason I was born and came into the world is to testify to the truth. Everyone on the side of truth listens to me." "What is truth?" retorted Pilate. And with this, he went out again to the Jews gathered there and said, "I find no basis for a charge against him, but it is your custom for me to release to you one prisoner at the time of the Passover. Do you want me to release the king of the Jews?" And they shouted back, "No, not him. Give us Barabbas." Now Barabbas had taken part in the uprising. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Third word from John chapter 19. Near to the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to his mother, "Dear woman, here is your son." And to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, this disciple took her into his home. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, we find ourselves again kneeling at the foot of the cross with our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, along with Mary, his mother, a few other women, and a disciple named John. We're here to hear his words, words that will heal us, words that will mend a relationship so desperately needed, and removing our sin for our eternal salvation. But this day we struggle looking at Jesus, our Savior, our friend, who came to this earth to save us. looking unrecognizable, even to his own mother this day. This is no longer the cute little baby she first held in her arms. This man is beaten, his body broken for you and for me. Blood and sweat pouring off of his forehead, blocking his eyes. But yet, our loving Savior looks out, looking for those he came to save, looking to you and to me, who haven't even been born yet, calling out to you with words of compassion, words that we so desperately need to hear, not just this day, but every day of our life. He looks out, and he can see his mother and a disciple whom he loved. He now is hanging there, not just as her son, but as her Savior. And he's going to make sure that she knows this. He says to her, "Woman, behold your son." And he says to John, "Behold, this is your mother." What we're hearing here is a God that cares about relationships. Yes, he's here to remove sin, but he's here to mend a relationship that was broken so many years before in the garden. Here we find God coming to us to mend that relationship, bringing us back into the family of God the Father. This is what this day is about. It's a glorious day, even though we don't want to look up at him. But we hear his words of compassion. Throughout this day, you will hear it. And I hope that you open your Bibles throughout the week and open it and hear it each day. "Woman, behold your son." I'm sure she's pondering now the words of that angel. Remember the one at Christmas we love to hear about, promising a Savior would come? These are easy words to hear. And she says, "I am the Lord's servant. May your words to me be fulfilled." And yet this day is day we're hearing words from Simeon right after Jesus' birth. Words that Mary don't want to remember, but she's witnessing that a sword would pierce her heart, her soul. But this needed to be done. This needed to be done for our salvation and for Mary and for John, for you and for me, for this entire world. It is a day we call Good Friday, even though Jesus is far from being good right now. For he's taking upon the sins of all of us. For every man, woman, and child, he's taking them for us so that he can remove them forever. To remind you that you are his. We will hear that in just 3 short days again. But God needs to restore a broken relationship with you. And that is what we're witnessing on that cross today. God is all about relationships. Mary now needs someone else to care for her. For Joseph is long gone. Jesus, the oldest son who is to care for her, is now going to be laid in a tomb in a few short hours. And he says to John, "Here is your mother." He cares about, yes, our eternal salvation, but he loves you enough to care about your life today. And we need to know this. Mary is facing what no parent should face, the death of a child. This is the worst thing that can happen to anybody. And I know this to be true. You can talk to me when you see me here a few times, and I will share with you the love of God. Because he shared his love with me first. Because on December 28, 1989, I buried my 24-year-old wife and my 3-year-old son. And I walked away from him for 13 years, even though he brought me a new wife 4 years later, who brought me back into his life, where he can introduce himself to me again as my loving God. Not a God that took my wife and son, but a God that loved my wife and son so they can spend eternity with him, so that I can spend eternity with them, so you can spend eternity with them. We have a loving God, my friends, a God that loves you so much he died for you. And oh, I wish I could share the news that happens in 3 days, but I trust that Pastor Mark and Pastor Steve will do an okay job. We have a God that came for you, for me, and for this world. Rejoice, even though we suffer watching him in pain and agony. Know that his body was broken and he bled for you. This is a God that we come here and we kneel at the foot of the cross, hearing his words of grace and of mercy, of affection for you. Not just for Mary, not just for John, not just for those women there, but for you, for me, and for this world. Cling to his promises. Hope is soon around the corner. He is there for you today. He cared enough for Mary's salvation by dying. He cared enough for her temporal life by giving her John. Who is he bringing into your life that you can care for? Because he's all about relationships. That's why you're here as a family of believers, to care for each other, to love each other just as he has loved you. And when you guys mess up and hurt each other, forgive each other like he's doing right now on a cross, forgiving you of all of your sins. How much easier is it to forgive one sin that your wife or husband did this morning, or 10 if you're me? And don't ask my wife, because she'll tell you the truth. We have a God that is here for you now. Hold on to him, trust him, and believe him. In Jesus' name, amen.
And we pray. And Lord Jesus, as we hear this word of affection today, being reminded that even in your suffering, in that excruciating pain of a cross, you would be present enough to know those around you that loved you so dearly, that you'd provide for them, that you'd remind them that you even care about relationships. Lord, we pray for those relationships in our lives to be restored at the foot of the cross, where forgiveness is needed, where grace is needed to be extended. Lord, give us that heart today. In your presence as a God who does exactly that in our relationship with you. So we give you thanks. Let us bless the Lord.
Thank you.
pray. Almighty God, we ask you graciously to behold this, your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hands of wicked people and to suffer death upon the cross. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. The Passion Reading. Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged. The soldiers twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They clothed him in a purple robe and went up to him again and again, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews!" And they slapped him in the face. Once more, Pilate came out and said to the Jews gathered there, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no basis for a charge against him." When Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." As soon as the chief priests and their officials saw him, they shouted, "Crucify! Crucify!" But Pilate answered, "You take him and crucify him. As for me, I find no basis for a charge against him." The Jewish leaders insisted, "We have a law, and according to that law he must die, because he claimed to be the Son of God." When Pilate heard this, he was even more afraid and went back inside the palace. "Where do you come from?" he asked Jesus, but Jesus gave him no answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Pilate said. "Don't you realize I have power either to free you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me if it were not given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to set Jesus out and sat down on the judge's seat at the place known as the stone pavement, which in Aramaic is Gabbatha. It was the day of preparation of the Passover. It was about noon. "Here is your king," Pilate said to the Jews. But they shouted, "Take him away! Take him away! Crucify him!" "Shall I crucify your king?" Pilate asked. "We have no king but Caesar," the chief priests answered. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
And as we turn now to the fourth word, this word of despair from our Savior Jesus from Matthew 27. "From the sixth hour until the ninth hour, darkness came over the whole land. In about the ninth hour, Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani,' which means, 'My God, why have you forsaken me?' And when some of those standing nearby heard this, they said, 'He's calling Elijah.'" My God, why? Why? You've said it before yourself. You have. My God, why? Right? We call it out. You're like, why, God? Why now? Why my spouse? Why my friend? Why this tragedy? Why this circumstance? Why this issue? Why this pain? Why this suffering? I mean, we're professionals at calling out, why, God, why? So how do we answer this call out of the darkness on a day like today? Especially when those words are spoken by none other than our Savior, Jesus, who would call out to the Father, why? How do you answer it? You know, they say that millions and millions of dollars have been spent in many professional counselors' offices dealing with one of the major issues and dysfunctions that pretty much all of us deal with, and that is the fear of abandonment. It's real. It brings on, as a result, high anxiety and concern of just how to function. You can call it a lot of different things. Sometimes it's called autophobia, sometimes called monophobia, or isolophobia, or even eremophobia. But the impact is all the same. It all comes down to a fear of abandonment, fear of being hurt by somebody leaving us, walking away from us, ignoring us. And like I say, it leads to symptoms of anxiety and worry. And whether we've diagnosed it or realized it or not, it's something a lot of us deal with pretty much every day. Fear of being left out, forgotten, abandoned. The reality is so often we often face our relationship with God in the same way. As other people have hurt us and let us down or walked away or aren't there anymore, or as Jerry reminded us a moment ago, when somebody that was once part of our life isn't there and we blame God, we say, God, if you really loved us, if you really cared about us, why? And we can live with deep anger and resentment. And what happens in our fear of abandonment is we take the same approach to God and we hold him at an arm's distance, and we really never really allow ourselves to be brought into that place where God desires us, because after all, he might let us down, so we won't allow it. And we push him back in our sinful, broken reality of minds that are messed up, in our thinking and dysfunctional in our actions. And yet our God comes to us today. And he reminds us that there's a moment that comes in the midst of this brutal place on a cross where our God would face it on our behalf. And he too would be abandoned, would experience the fullness. And you put this together with me for a moment. I mean, Jesus with his Father, this is something that he would always talk about, his relationship with his Father. He'd get away, he'd wake up early in the morning to go commune with his Father in prayer. He would make it clear to his disciples and anyone who would hear it how close he was to the Father, that he and the Father are one, he would say. Those that were witnesses of his ministry, they heard it multiple times, where at his baptism or up on the Mount of Transfiguration, as heard by Peter, James, and John, that the Father's voice would thunder from the clouds and say, this is my Son whom I love, with him I am well pleased. And yet that same one, in this moment, a moment of despair, would call out, my God, why? Why have you forsaken me? It seems like such a strange reality for God himself as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit to experience seemingly a separation in this moment, a dysfunction, as it were, in the relationship. And yet, in God's economy of grace and mercy and love, and what it would take for us to be brought back into our relationship of holding him and pushing him away, Jesus would face that abandonment for us, something we deserve. You know, theologians argue about the reality of what that means in that moment. You know, they say, we confess it, right, in our creeds, that he descended into hell. And yet, as we see biblically where that moment happens, it seems to be more of a proclamation moment, where Jesus appears before those who have died and rejected God long ago to proclaim victory over sin and death. That seems to happen later, but what's going on in this moment, when other theologians have said the true definition of hell is the absence of God, or where God turns his back on your reality? It would seem Jesus is experiencing it here. Well, the Father has turned his back on his Son. My God, why? That Jesus would experience hell on your behalf. What kind of love does it take to willingly and purposefully enter into that reality as the Son of God? And as he would recite those words, Eloi, Eloi, lama sabachthani. And it's interesting, you get a glimpse of how terrible his suffering really was on that day, because he garbles up the language a bit. It's both Aramaic and Hebrew kind of being interspersed in that little phrase. Maybe signaling how painful and hurtful and overwhelmed with exhaustion he truly was. Quoting Psalm 22 in fulfillment of those words once spoken by David, and now fulfilled by the Son of David, the Messiah who had come in the darkness to face abandonment by the Father. You know, in that moment, there's a greater thing theologically happening as well in this sacrifice that would now be complete. They say that when that ninth hour came, when these words very likely were spoken by Jesus, that in Jerusalem that day, the shofar, the ram's horn, would have been blown by the priest, signaling the end of the evening sacrifice. And as Jesus would speak out and cry out in the abandonment of it all, the Lamb of God who would be slain for the sin of the world, a fulfillment of that payment for sin, once and for all, blood that would be shed, a Savior who would face it for us. My God, why? Or as theologian and songwriter Michael Card would write it, he'd say, it may be the most painful question any human can ask. At its even visceral, most visceral level, it is not a request for information so much as a howl of anguish. And as far as we know it, it was the only time Jesus ever asked his Father why. My God, why? You and I know the answer. Jesus was forsaken at Golgotha because of our sin. But now, because of the redemption Jesus purchased for us in darkness, we can live forever in God's light because of the separation he endured for us, who have so often turned our back on our Father. We now have that guaranteed. He will never, ever forsake us. For those who have ever asked the question, why? Now we know. In Jesus' name, amen.
Drawn to the cross which thou hast blessed with healing gifts.
We pray. Lord, in our anguish so often, we cry out, why? Why are we broken? Why are we diseased? Why are we suffering? Why did they die? We know the answer. The answer is because of Adam's sin and our sin. And yet, as your followers, then we cry out, why? Why did you endure the cross for us? Why did you shed your blood? Why did you show such love? And the answer is because you would not abandon us. So, Lord, remind us always in the midst of our human frailty that you are a God beyond that frailty, a God who meets us, who is with us, who comforts us, and who will take us home to be with you forever. In your name, Jesus, amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Oh,
We pray. Almighty God, we ask you graciously to behold this, your family, for which our Lord Jesus was content to be betrayed and given up into the hands of wicked people and to suffer death upon the cross. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end. Amen. The Passion Reading. Finally, Pilate handed him over to be crucified. So the soldiers took charge of Jesus. Carrying his own cross, he went out to the place of the skull, which in Aramaic is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with him two others, one on each side, and Jesus in the middle. Pilate had a notice prepared and fastened to the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this sign, for the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and the sign was written in Aramaic, Latin, and Greek. The chief priests of the Jews protested to Pilate, "Do not write the King of the Jews, but that this man claimed to be the King of the Jews." Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers crucified Jesus, they took his clothes, dividing them into four shares, one for each of them, with the undergarment remaining. This garment was seamless, woven in one piece from top to bottom. "Let's not tear it," they said to one another. "Let's decide by lot who will get it." This happened that the scripture might be fulfilled that said, "They divided my clothes among them and cast lots for my garment." So this is what the soldiers did. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
The fifth word, according to John chapter 19. Later, knowing that all was completed, and so the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge on the stalk of a hyssop and lifted it to Jesus' lips. A sponge on a stick. As a native Minnesotan, and yes, Mark found another one, I associate anything on a stick with fair food. But a sponge on a stick tends to be anything but. It's a tool for satisfying that basic human need to be hydrated. I've also come to recognize a sponge on a stick as a sign of death and dying. As I visit members in the hospital whose days are numbered, I oftentimes see the accompanying sign, a little white styrofoam coffee cup with a plastic stick poking out the top. You might think it looks kind of like a sucker, but you pull out the stick and you see that little blue sponge, ready to bring just an ounce of relief to the person who is suffering. That sponge, that stick, and even this sense of thirst that Jesus experiences is so associated with dying. As we experience death, as our bodies fail, we exert a tremendous amount of energy and water in trying to make up for what we've lost. And as Jesus experienced the cross, he too had every reason to thirst. In the hours since he had been nailed and lifted up on the cross, his heart has been working twice as hard as normal due to both the blood loss and the awkward position of his arms and his head as he hung there. His lungs are working in overdrive as his body fills with fluid, responding to the scourging that he has taken and the stress that he is under. He's running about 36 hours now without sleep, spending the last evening being beaten, put on trial, paraded through the city. Much of that under extreme stress and duress, even to the point where we find him in the garden sweating blood. So yes, Jesus had every reason to be thirsty. He was suffering. But I don't think it was just his physical pain that was causing him torment. You can add in a broken heart. I'd like to let you in on a little secret that I hope is not a secret for everyone. God didn't have to make you. He didn't have to make me either. He didn't have to make any of this, and yet he did anyway. So why? Why would he go through the trouble of making all of this apart from love? God foreknew this creation in such a way that he loved it and couldn't help but make it. He created a place that, even with all of the love he poured into it, still immediately rejected him and rebelled against him. You can pile that heartbreak and rejection on his pain. A voice that many of you may be familiar with, I think, puts good words to this kind of torment of both body and soul. Dietrich Bonhoeffer, the Lutheran pastor and member of the resistance against the Nazis in World War II, wrote quite a bit while he was in prison. The following words are from a poem that he wrote to his fiancée Maria shortly before the end of the war, as he saw both a sign of hope and perhaps release, but also knew that this may mean his death. He writes, "The old year would still try our hearts to torment. Of evil times we still do bear the weight. O Lord, do grant our souls now terror-stricken salvation for which you did us create." And that was the promise of Jesus, that salvation in the face of torment and suffering. And he came into a world of torment of suffering. Torment and suffering. He came to bring love to those who had rejected and rebelled against him. He came to bring salvation to those whom he had created out of love, that they would receive it and be healed. He was willing to endure the suffering, the curse that we face to the nth degree, so that we wouldn't have to. And now we, beloved church, beloved of our Creator, can rest in that truth. And once again, Bonhoeffer puts words to our hope. By powers of good so wondrously protected, we wait with confidence, befall what may. God is with us at night and in the morning, and oh, most certainly on each new day. Amen.
We pray. Lord, in our human lives, so often we thirst. We thirst for grandeur and we thirst for success. We thirst for those things that cannot be a part of us. And we look all around for ways to satisfy that thirst. But Lord, you came into this world to give to us streams of living water that flow out of you and into us, that we may not thirst again, but may be filled by your love, your mercy, and your forgiveness on the cross, and that that water might overflow in us to the world around us. So fill us, Lord, and fill that thirst within us that it may forever give water of life to the world that you died to redeem. In your name, amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
pray. Almighty God, we ask you graciously to behold this, your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hand of wicked people and to suffer death upon the cross. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
The Passion Reading. Near the cross of Jesus stood his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother there, and the disciple whom he loved standing nearby, he said to her, "Woman, here is your son," and to the disciple, "Here is your mother." From that time on, the disciple took her into his home. Later, knowing that everything had now been finished, and so that the scripture would be fulfilled, Jesus said, "I am thirsty." A jar of wine vinegar was there, so they soaked a sponge in it and put the sponge on a stalk of the hyssop plant and lifted it to Jesus' lips. When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." With that, he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
When he had received the drink, Jesus said, "It is finished." In the Greek, the phrase "it is finished" is only one word, tetelestai. This is one of the most important words in Scripture, one of the most important words spoken by our Lord Jesus Christ. To understand the full weight of this word, "it is finished," a good analogy would be back when you used to pay a bill or get a receipt from something, they would take a stamp and they would stamp your receipt, and in blood red it would say, "paid in full." That is what this word means. The price has been paid in full. It is finished. There is nothing else that must be done, and there is nothing else that can be done. The work is completed. There is no more work required. The mission is accomplished. But what is finished? What did Jesus accomplish? Well, I am a poor, miserable sinner, but Jesus became sin for us. No sin is left out. No sinner is left behind. It is finished. I was drowning in the debt of my sins, but Jesus has paid all of our debts in full. Everyone's debt is paid by his blood. It is finished. I deserve God's full wrath for the punishment of my sins. But God's wrath was poured out on our Lord Jesus Christ. It is finished. I was once an enemy of God, but Christ has reconciled all of us to the Father by his work on the cross. The relationship has been restored. Our sins are remembered no more. It is finished. There is nothing that I could ever do to earn my salvation, because Christ has earned salvation for all. It is finished. The sacrifice of Christ is done. It is finished. Our salvation is complete. When Jesus says, "It is finished," it is truly finished. We are all set free from sin. We no longer need to fear the punishment of hell that we deserve. And so now, we are set free. We are set free to serve. We are set free to serve Jesus in everlasting righteousness, innocence, and blessedness. And we do this by serving those who God has placed around us. We are free. We are set free to serve our neighbors, the strangers around us, and even our enemies. We serve them with the same love that Jesus has shown us. It is finished. Amen.
Pray. It is finished. You spoke those words in finality. Lord, we know so often in our lives we want to revisit our sin. But you say over us, it is finished. So, Lord, by the power of your Spirit, enable us also to move on from what we have done that has broken your heart, to see instead in the words, "It is finished," you pour out love over us. Let that love fill us once again in the darkness of our failures, that we may see the light of your face once again, that we too may say along with you, it is finished. I belong to Christ. I am his. My sin is paid for. It cannot be revisited. Lord, by your grace and by your mercy, grant us this power through your cross and resurrection. In your name, amen. Let us bless the Lord.
Thank you.
Almighty God, we ask you graciously to behold this your family, for which our Lord Jesus Christ was content to be betrayed and given up into the hand of wicked people and to suffer death upon the cross. Through the same Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and rules with you and the Holy Spirit, ever one God, world without end.
Amen.
And a reading from the Passion. Now it was the day of preparation, and the next day was to be a special Sabbath. And because the Jewish leaders did not want the bodies left on the crosses during the Sabbath, they asked Pilate to have the legs broken and the bodies taken down. The soldiers therefore came and broke the legs of the first man who had been crucified with Jesus, and then those of the other. But when they came to Jesus and found that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced Jesus' side with a spear, bringing a sudden flow of blood and water. The man who saw it has given testimony, and his testimony is true. He knows that he tells the truth, and he testifies so that you also may believe. These things happen so that the scripture would be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And as another scripture says, they will look on the one they have pierced. Now later, Joseph of Arimathea asked Pilate for the body of Jesus. Now Joseph was a disciple of Jesus, but secretly, because he feared the Jewish leaders. And with Pilate's permission, he came and took the body away. He was accompanied by Nicodemus, the same man who earlier had visited Jesus at night. Nicodemus brought a mixture of myrrh and aloes, about 75 pounds. And taking Jesus' body, the two of them wrapped it with the spices and strips of linen. And this was in accordance with Jewish burial customs. At the place where Jesus was crucified, there was a garden, and in the garden, a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And because it was the Jewish day of preparation, and since the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This is the gospel of the Lord.
Seventh word. It was about the sixth hour, and darkness came over the whole land until the ninth hour, for the sun had stopped shining, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two. Jesus called out with a loud voice, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." When he had said this, he breathed his last. I want to take you back 95 days for a moment. 95 days ago, it was Christmas. There was an announcement. "Fear not, for behold, I bring you tidings of great joy. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord." You know, we rehearse those words in a confessional form throughout the year when we say, "Who for us and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man. We rehearse those words of the Christmas narrative. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. For Jesus, 33 years has passed since that coming. There is no joy this day, only sorrow and agony and darkness and suffering and pain. Jesus, very God of very God, is hanging on a cross, drawing his last breath. 95 days ago, there was joy. Now there is torn flesh and bruised tissue and massive blood loss and critical medical trauma. The spectacle, the gross miscarriage of justice, is almost finished. There is just one more phrase to utter, and Jesus, his mouth moistened by vinegar, speaks those words, "Father, into your hands I commit my spirit." It had been only moments before, in the horrific darkness of our sin, that it had blotted out Jesus' view of his eternal being one with the Father, and agony had taken over as he cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me?" Now he has pronounced the final verdict on our sin. It has been paid for by his suffering, paid for by his blood, paid for forever. Now Jesus can once again see the face of the one who has loved him from eternity. The gavel of the judgment for our sin has sounded in heaven. The punishment for that sin has been endured. And Jesus is entrusting his future to the love of his Father. Jesus had said, "The reason my Father loves me is that I lay down my life, only to take it up again. No one takes it from me, but I lay it down of my own accord. I have authority to lay it down and authority to take it up again. This command I received from my Father." He has laid down his life for sinners, for you and for me, for all who will despise him throughout time, for all who have no use of God. So Jesus utters words that reach back 33 years, 95 days, to the birth in a manger. He has accomplished what he came for. The Son of Man has come to seek and to save those who are lost, and to give his life as a ransom for many. That price, the ransom, the debt, the payment, has been made forever. Sin, the entire world's sin, our sin, that had tallied up upon God's holy ledger, that resulted in such enormous consequences for us that there would never be any hope on our part of paying it off. Much like the parable that Jesus told of the man who owed such an enormous debt, a lifetime would never pay it off. Jesus had paid for it. The ledger was wiped clean, washed with blood. He had done it for the world's human inhabitants. For God so loved the world, the past, the present, and the future. And because of this, as he said, the Father loves him. And Jesus is confident now in that love. And in that love, he lays down his life and entrusts his spirit. Now nothing can keep us apart from the love of the Father as his children. Now nothing can keep us out of heaven. Satan cannot stand with an accusing finger pointed at us. But the cost for all of this has been incredible. On this day, we do not sing Christmas songs. We sing songs of lament and sorrow over the tragedy of the innocent dying for the guilty. And yet this day brings for us eternal joy. By this final act of trust on Jesus' part, we have been transformed from creatures lost and separated from their Creator to now being cherished sons and daughters who call out, Abba, our Father, who art in heaven. Through its saying, our slate has been forever wiped clean. We do not have to repay the debt we owed, for Jesus paid it for us. Our work now is not an act of repayment, but an act of gratitude toward the one who completed our salvation. As angels watched over Jesus' manger with wondering love, so now they will watch over the body of their Master and Lord as he is laid in the tomb for 3 days. He has done for humans what is a mystery to them. They will watch, and in 3 days their joy will erupt as the Father raises his only Son to life, to prove to all creation the strife is over, the battle won. For us now, words of committal take on a new hope. Ashes to ashes, dust to dust does not end there. In the sure and certain hope of the resurrection through our Lord Jesus Christ, who will change our mortal bodies to be like his glorious bodies by the power that enables him to subdue all things unto himself. The tomb cannot hold him. The Father, his Father, will raise him to life on the third day and give him all authority over heaven and earth, over you and me, over death and hell, over the grave. And he will raise us up on the last day. Amen.
Lord, come, Lord, come, come, pray.
And we pray. Lord Jesus, as you committed your spirit, so may we today, as we beheld what you were willing to do for us as our God and Savior, commit the spirit you have given us, a spirit that leads us to believe and trust and know. May we commit our way, our lives, our thoughts, all that we are, in service and honor to you, the one who died for us, and a Savior who goes with us now. As we find hope that there is forgiveness, there is grace, the payment has been made in full, it is finished. Lord Jesus, go with us now, with that spirit that leads us back in the coming days to celebrate the hope that is truly fulfilled in an empty tomb. So we give you thanks. In Jesus we pray. Let us bless the Lord.